The Rachel Maddow Show, weeknights at 9 Eastern on MSNBC.
The Rachel Maddow Show starts right now. Good evening, Rachel.
Good evening, Ed. At the, you know, my local bar here in New York City is a Steelers bar.
Okay,
and so
way to go, Rachel.
At the risk of getting like either way too many free drinks or none ever in the rest of my life, I have to say it was a pretty exciting end of the game.
Thank you.
Well done, man. Thanks a lot.
You bet.
Thanks to you at home for staying with us for this special Sunday. 2 days to go, Monster Truck Election Derby special edition of The Rachel Maddow Show. We've been waiting to do that all year long. All right, are you ready? Today we saw some of the largest crowds we have seen at political rallies this entire election season. Mitt Romney spoke to an estimated 4,500 people in Des Moines, Iowa this morning. Then Governor Romney flew to Cleveland, Ohio, where another 6,000 plus people showed up to hear him speak. Then he went to Pennsylvania. After that, he bolted for Virginia. This is a big, big day for the Romney campaign. Just as this is a big, big day for the Obama campaign, President Obama's schedule today includes a late-night rally in Aurora, Colorado. It's also in Cincinnati, Ohio. The president drew a crowd of 23,000 people this afternoon in Hollywood, Florida, after 24,000 people turned out last night to hear him in Virginia. Think about that, 24,000 people in Virginia last night, 23,000 people in Florida today. In Concord, New Hampshire this morning, when 14,000 people turned out to hear President Obama, that was the largest crowd ever assembled for a political event in the entire state of New Hampshire, in the entire history of the state of New Hampshire. I realize New Hampshire may not be big, but New Hampshire is old, and this was the biggest political rally ever held in the state of New Hampshire for the entire time that New Hampshire has existed. We cannot be sure why more people are turning out to hear President Obama today than are turning out to hear Mitt Romney. I mean, maybe it's just the power of incumbency. People want to go hear a president speak, no matter who the president is, just because he is a president. Governor Romney's rallies today have been significantly smaller than Mr. Obama's, but still, for the Romney campaign, these are the best numbers they've ever had. These are really quite good crowds. All around, for both campaigns, these are huge crowds in relative terms and in absolute terms. And now is the part of the campaign where we also start watching another variety of huge crowd. Look at this. Oh, man. Crowds of people lining up to vote in Florida. We have been getting reports that the wait for early voting in Florida can last for an hour or 2 hours or 4 hours or 5 hours or 8 hours. Viewers of this show have been sending us these pictures of people losing entire workdays in an effort to cast a ballot. And it's not as if Florida has had some kind of electoral accident where the situation surprised the officials in charge of running the election. Florida had seriously long lines for early voting in the last presidential election as well in 2008. And then after they had those long lines in 2008, Florida's new Republican governor, Rick Scott, last year decided to cut the days for early voting almost in half, obviously making a bad situation already worse. On Thursday, Florida Democrats plus one Republican county elections official plus the nonpartisan League of Women Voters all asked Governor Rick Scott to do what previous Republican governors have done when there have been long lines at Florida polls. They asked him to extend early voting for one day, this day, Sunday. Speaking to reporters at a Republican fundraiser on Thursday, Governor Scott said no. He said he wouldn't do it. He said early voting ends on Saturday night. Never mind about the giant lines. When we came into work today to start putting together this show, we found in our inbox this photo. Voters, citizens of Florida, Americans, lined up in the dark, in this case, in the pre-dawn, early morning, dark hours of Saturday, waiting to vote. Think about that. Pre-dawn. These people clearly hoped that if they got there early enough for the last day of early voting, they could make it through that line in time to go to work or get home to their families for a regular Saturday. But nope, not this year, not with Governor Rick Scott's rules restricting voting time. The line outside one polling place stretching out the door and down the sidewalk and around the corner and down some more sidewalk and also then across the big lawn. 4 hours later, when you got through all of that and you finally made it inside the building, you made it inside the library where you were allowed to vote, you were still not done with the waiting. The person who sent us this picture reported waiting a total of 8.5 hours to vote in Miami-Dade County. Happy Saturday. Welcome to democracy, Florida style. I don't know how you spent your Saturday night, but in Miami, thousands of people appear to have spent Saturday night standing in line waiting to vote. Everybody who got in line before the polls closed at 7 was supposed to be allowed to vote last night. Well, in Miami-Dade, the wait at that point was still several hours long. So the last voter in Miami-Dade County last night checked into the voting place at 1 o'clock in the morning, having been there a minimum of 6 hours already by the time they checked in to vote. Voting is not supposed to work like this. I'm not sure that democracy as an exercise or an institution or the way we choose our leaders can work like this. You are not supposed to need to bring food and water and a chair in order to vote. You're not supposed to need an entire day off work or a sitter to watch your kids all day long in order to vote. But that is what Governor Rick Scott said would be just fine for the people of Florida. After seeing long lines, especially in South Florida, where a third of the state's registered Democrats live, after seeing long lines, he said, let's make them longer. Let's make them longer for this election. Long lines are fine with me. And because Governor Rick Scott would offer no help, South Florida, after asking for help on Thursday night, South Florida woke up to even longer lines this weekend. Very early this morning, the Florida Democratic Party sued in federal court, asking a judge to do what Florida's Republican governor is refusing to do, namely to make it possible to vote in Florida without enduring a kind of democracy marathon in order to do it. Faced with that lawsuit and with the evident problem of voters not being able to vote, a few Florida counties decided maybe they had better do something after all on their own. These counties came up with basically a make-do workaround plan. You still could not technically early vote today in most of Florida, but around the city of Tampa, in Pinellas County, and in Hillsborough County, you could pick up an over-the-counter absentee ballot. You could fill it out there and then hand it in right there. You could do that all day in Greater Tampa. In Orange County, which includes Orlando, a judge ordered a day of early voting today after a bomb scare kept the polls closed there yesterday for several hours. The situation in Miami-Dade County got really kind of nuts today. At least that's how it seems to me. I was watching reporting from Miami-Dade all day today, and it started to feel like farce. After people were still voting last night at 1 in the morning in Miami-Dade, Miami-Dade finally, belatedly, decided that they were going to let people pick up absentee ballots today, fill them out, and hand them in, just like was happening in a few other Florida counties. Okay, so far, right? But we have seen already what happens in Florida these days when you offer people the chance to vote. Turns out, they want to vote. And they try to vote. Oh no, we're not prepared for that. So today, nearly 200 people got in line outside the Elections Bureau in the town of Doral, which is a Republican-leading town, and the only place you could vote today in Miami-Dade County. Imagine that. They said you could vote there, so voters turned up trying to vote, which of course occasioned a freakout. The election staff locked the doors. First, they said they did not have the equipment or the staff to handle voting that day. Then they gave another reason for the shutdown. They said the mayor, Republican mayor, had not signed off on the plan. Whatever the reason for a Miami-Dade saying, hey, everybody, come vote today. And then when people showed up to vote, they locked the doors on them. Whatever the reasons were why they did that, the crowd at that voting place would not leave.
Let us vote! Let us vote! Let us vote! Let us vote!
One voter who waited for two hours with her four-year-old grandson told the Miami Herald, quote, this is America, not a third world country. The Herald says most people did stay in line even after elections officials closed the door on them. And then somebody started towing cars out of the parking lot where people had parked to be there trying to vote. An hour later, an hour after locking its doors on the voters lined up outside, after people's cars had started to be towed out of the lot they had parked in order to be there. An hour later, Miami-Dade reconsidered its decision to reconsider. The county relented and they opened the doors. They say anybody who got in line by 5 p.m. could cast an in-person absentee ballot. When the deadline rolled around, there were still 400 people waiting. We are told that campaign workers started then handing out water and granola bars because it's only reasonable to expect that those Florida citizens might be thirsty and hungry and tired and maybe furious by the time they got to vote. And frankly, because those voters are heroes just for finishing what they started. Maybe it is just me and how I remember things, but I did not grow up with the expectation that casting a ballot was supposed to be an endurance sport. It's not supposed to be an obstacle course. Voting is a good and right and civic thing to do, but we do not expect it to be a matter of personal heroism. Not on this scale, not for thousands of people, not because one Republican governor says that is the way he wants it to be. We'll have Steve Kornacki here in just a moment to analyze the impact of this type of debacle on the election overall. But joining us now is one of the combatants in this current fight right now in Florida. Scott Arsenault is the executive director of the Florida Democratic Party, which is suing for more early voting in the Sunshine State of 8-hour lines to vote. Mr. Arsenault, thank you very much for your time. I know you're very busy.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. Appreciate it.
It was amazing watching the real-time reporting today coming out of South Florida, what was going on there. First of all, let me ask you if I got anything wrong there in terms of trying to explain what's going on, and let me ask if you have any updates for us on the current battle over these early voting rules.
Well, you've got it absolutely right, Rachel. And what we've seen here is just an explosion of enthusiasm from Florida voters, particularly Democrats, all across the state, really having a record early vote. I mean, we had on Saturday the largest early vote in Florida history, and it's just been great to see. But what you've also seen is the problems that come with it when you have a Republican governor who's decided that he really just doesn't want people to vote. We've had tremendously long lines, and we frankly decided we had to do something last night, which was file this lawsuit. But we've also seen our supervisors across the state, a lot of them step up on their own and allow folks to have what you correctly called over-the-counter voting, which is essentially early voting in some of our large areas where you've seen a lot of these lines.
In terms of the overall effect of this kind of chaos today, however things were resolved ultimately in Miami-Dade today with just that fiasco, but also with the long, 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 long waits to early vote and the confusion over when and where people would be allowed to vote, is that confusion and that chaos itself suppressive? Do fewer people end up voting because they're worried that they don't know what to expect if they try to cast their ballot and they can't plan their lives around that kind of uncertainty?
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, this is not the way it's supposed to work. Voting is supposed to be something that we're making easier for people to do, not harder. But what we're seeing is that people are overcoming these obstacles. People want to vote in this election. People feel passionately about the president. His message has really broken through here in Florida. And people are they're overcoming those obstacles. I mean, you call them heroes, and they are. I mean, they're standing in line for 8, sometimes 9 hours to vote. And I think that's incredible. It's important. And I think we're going to see this here in Florida through Tuesday.
What is your strategy from the Democratic Party's perspective in terms of tomorrow and Election Day as well? Obviously, a lot more polling places will be open on Election Day. But I think we can expect, given what we've seen so far, that it still may be tough. What's your party strategy?
Well, tomorrow, Monday, we're going to have 6 Florida counties that are going to allow essentially early vote or over-the-counter voting. We've already getting the word out in those counties to get folks out to the polls tomorrow who want to vote early the day before. And again, like you've mentioned, a lot of folks that aren't going to be able to vote on Tuesday because they have to work. So we're going to make sure that gets done tomorrow. And then we're ready for Tuesday. We've got the largest, strongest ground game that Florida's ever seen. We're ready for Election Day, and we think we're going to have a tremendous turnout on Tuesday.
Scott Arsenault, Executive Director of the Florida Democratic Party. Thank you for being here tonight, sir. Keep us posted.
Thank you.
You know, it is not rocket science here, right? I mean, the more opportunities people have to vote and the easier it is to vote, the more people vote. The more people vote, both parties agree, the better it is for Democrats. That's all this is. Your voting rights are at the mercy of a partisan decision process. And in this case, partisan state leadership. That's all this is.